Living Seed Media brings to you God's Word, which is His comprehensive equipment for changing lives. May the Lord impact your heart as you encounter His Word. For further inquiry or counsel, contact Peace House, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Telephone numbers 0703-036-3659, 0703-768-1198. Email address lsmedia@livingseed.org or visit our website at www.livingseed.org. Let us sit back and listen as the servant of God brings forth the word of life.
First Corinthians chapter 3. We'll begin reading from verse 9 through 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, from verse 9 through 15. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. By the grace God has given me, I laid a foundation as an expert builder, and someone else is building on it. But each one should be careful how he builds. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. If any man builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, his work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each man's work. If what he has built survives, he will receive his reward. If it is burned up, he will suffer loss. He himself will be saved, but only as one escaping through the flames. Ministry with accountability in view. Ministering with accountability in view. That's the topic that the Lord laid on my heart for myself and for my colleagues. And I know this thing is such a serious one. And what we have heard last night definitely must have opened our eyes, and particularly mine, to the seriousness of the message God wants to pass on to me personally, and to all of us, and of course from us to others that are not here, because we are stewards of what is being sown, what is being deposited in us to share with the generality of our people wherever the Lord will grant us that grace. And I perceive that the Lord has some serious messages for me at this year's retreat. And I'm grateful to God for this opportunity to share the Word of God again to my senior colleagues and fellow ministers. I know the issue of accountability is a recurring biblical theme. We can't run away from it. As you read the Old Testament, you'll find places where we are warned that we will give account of whatever we are given as God's chosen vessels, even to the generality of the people, Ecclesiastes chapter 12. Actually reminds us in verse 14 that the end of the matter is this, that each of us will give account of what we have done, what we have done with what the Lord God gave us. And of course, last night, we were referred to Ezekiel 33, and that is a very serious issue. That here I stand before you, a watchman. And this man and woman of God, watchmen, keeping watch over the souls of others. Amos 4:12 says, I must prepare myself to meet my God. And of course, when you read Malachi, you will find the issue of accountability there. And so by the time you come to New Testament, you will even find more. The Lord Jesus stressed that very seriously to his disciples and every believer. Matthew 24, 45 to 51, Matthew 25, 14 to 30, and the Roman passage referred to last night by our bishop, Romans 14:12. These are among others for us to know that the issue of accountability is extremely serious. Now, Paul's message to the confused church, the Corinthians, was partly to warn these people of the great danger of carnality as expressed by sectarianism in the fellowship. If it is in Africa, we will talk about tribalism. We will talk about clannishness. And it's simply carnal, fleshy. And Paul needed to address that. So he tried to help them to realize that knowing the serious implications of the precarious situation he found himself as a servant of the Lord, and besides, someone called literally at an old time after others have tasted the fresh thought of the Lord. He experienced his own encounter with him. And he felt small in relation to all other apostles that are giants far ahead of him. So Paul decided that he would not endorse their carnality. And that Peter, Apollo, other ministers were mere tools in God's hand. And if that is the case, they were ordinary stewards who will give account of their stewardship as at one due at the appropriate time. So there are four issues that I want to share with you from this passage. There's a whole lot. If you want to dissect verse 9 alone, calling us God's building, now we will have a whole lot about it. So I will limit myself to these four ideas, four things that I found in this passage. First of all, ministering with accountability in view calls for soberness and humility. Ministry with accountability in view demands soberness, calls for soberness and humility. You realize that Paul's emphasis on the grace of God is fully loaded in verse 10a. When he says, by the grace God has given me, he knew the humility of that opportunity and that privilege, and he never took it for granted. But he could be granted the big favor to lay the foundation for the body of Christ, Paul, the Corinthian church, the Ephesian church, the Galatian church, and several others. That his senior colleagues could not boast of. It is simply the grace of God. That calls for soberness. You could only say, who was that? Oh. It could have been Peter. It could have been his own disciple, Barnabas, or any other. For him, there is no room for pride. No one could dispense of him at any moment. John the Baptist, in response to those who thought he should be jealous of the one whom he introduced, simply said, a man can receive only what is given from heaven. So where lies my pride? If I begin to go here and get bragging, it is simply because of God's grace. And you recall the Lord Jesus talking about the need for all of us to be sober, to humble ourselves. Luke 17, 7 to 10, when he talks about a servant that is supposed to serve his master. And of course, he had already gone to the farm, taking care of what needed to be done. And on getting home, the master simply wanted him to make sure his own food would be ready again. And the Lord said, for that servant, he had no choice. The same applies to all of us. It is because of God's grace. In 1 Corinthians 4, verse 7 says, for who makes you different from anyone else? What do you have that you did not receive? And if you did receive it, why do you boast as though you did not? That's the seriousness of this thing for us. For me personally, when I was given the assignment to handle the affairs of the entire denomination, the first thing I started asking the Lord, which I told him, is this, that Ataria Janakuni, he said, Womadu, those of you who don't speak Yoruba, that proverb says the head of an elephant is not for a child to carry. The head of one giant animal, there's no way one little child can carry it. And so I simply ask, oh God, have mercy upon me. If it is PhD, oh, several others have plenty, smarter. But somehow, if the Lord will count me worthy, then I need inside. So ministry of accountability in view really calls for surveillance. So as you go around, maybe over junior ministers, over the church members, your leaders, please be aware. There is need for humility. Recognizing the fact that it is by the grace of God. Paul could bully his way over Peter and the rest. What do you people know? What have you done? But he realized that it is simply the grace of God. Secondly, what I see in this passage is that ministry with accountability in view calls for excelling in ministry. Calls for adding great value, excelling in ministry. For me personally, that chapter 10, verse B, that talks about, I know a foundation as an expert builder. Expert builder. Someone who must have done his homework thoroughly. And someone who decided that he would do something extraordinary. Standing. I mean, outstanding where others are standing. What are other pastors doing that I can do better under God? You recall David when someone started writing about all the leaders all over, and he recounted that concerning David, Psalm 78, verse 72. But this man separated the people of God with integrity of heart, and we are told with skill he led them. Let me ask you, where were the sons of Issachar when Saul was the king? Were they not there? And all the mighty warriors, as you read 1 Chronicles chapter 12, where were they? They were there. But someone prayed, and he was able to harness God's resources within the body. Because the Lord God has deposited so much, yielded so much within the congregation, within the nation. And Paul, I mean, David was able to identify them and brought them into his kingdom. And he added great value. And yet, today, you are still hearing about David, the great king, the star of David, any man. In spite of his shortcomings. But here is the guy who rather run back to God immediately he commits any sin or what have you. Ministry with accountability in view calls for excelling in ministry. I decided that I will have to be coming to this kind of retreat in order to be sharpened, in order to be penetrated, in order to be sandpapered, to make sure that the crookedness of my life will be straightened out, that some ministers, servants of the Lord will pump some spiritual energy in me, and as I go back to my duty post, it will begin to affect what I do. Because I know, apart from him, those of you know what Baptists do, or any denomination with congregational polity, I have to stand before the entire congregation to give account of my stewardship, year in, year out, actually periodically, before what we call the Executive Committee of the Nigerian Baptist Convention. That is even tonight. And I decided that I will not want to disappoint the people of God. But I would rather prefer, or I rather decide that it's Him who sent me in the first place. And with that view in mind, oh, I decided that whatever it will take, Lord, help me. Thank God for those individuals the Lord brought into my life around me, with whom the Lord did what He did through us for 10 solid years. So Paul added value to the body of Christ. And it was not even a stake to claim that the same grace of God enabled him to excel in ministry, even above others. Look at the same book, chapter 15, 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Just read verses 9 and 10, he says, "For I am the least of the apostles and do not even deserve to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And His grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them, yet not I, but the grace of God that was with me." Isn't that something? That's you. I begin to help me to work hard, burn the midnight oil, withdraw, in order to make sure that if David did something quite different and excellently than someone else, why not me? But during this tenure, oh God, that I will do something better. You recall Paul also urged Timothy to try to excel in ministry when he was serving the awesome God. But he must never handle the ministry with flippancy. And he knew that he will have to give account of his ministry. When you look at 1 Timothy chapter 4, 14 to 16, there you find Paul really encouraging the pastor, Timothy, his disciple, what he needed to do. 14 to 16, it says, "Do not neglect your gift, which was given you through a prophetic message. When the body of elders lay their hands on you, be diligent in these matters." Be diligent. In other words, excel in them. Give yourself wholly to them so that everyone may see your progress. I hope you are getting that. People may now realize that from one level to another, this individual continues to add greater value. That's why God picked on you. That's why the Lord set you apart and set me apart to make a difference. And He says, "Watch your life and doctrine closely. Persevere in them. Because if you do, you will forget yourself and your hearers." And you recall, you asked Him to be diligent, to excel in handling the word of truth, the word of God. 2 Timothy 2:15. "Be able to dissect the word of God accurately, split it into pieces in a manner that people will realize that the skeleton is being unfleshed." Of course, Titus received the same challenge, Titus 2:7-8. And Peter was not even left out of this when he challenged all of us. 2 Peter 1:5-9. "You know, after your faith, hard work, and this on and on and on, continue to increase, continue to expand to your knowledge. And when you read the word Peter, he also talks about it. For him, he says, if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, that's verse 8, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Increasing measure. Is it in preaching? It is in teaching. And let me tell you, is it in withdrawing? To go and hide somewhere. Can I do something better? I'm not just talking about noise making. To let people know that I can spend hours in night vigil and all of that. Can I do something better than being a teacher for others in relation to this? The bottom line is, people of God, none of you and this individual standing here should be a maintenance officer, pastor, bishop. The only thing you know how to do is to leave the church the way you met it. The ball is blown. Maintenance officer, remove it, replace it. Burn, remove it, replace it. And sometimes some of us may even leave the church, the parish, the entire denominational districts, the way we met it, or even worse for it. May the Lord have mercy upon us. And I've also forgotten that one day is coming when the owner will now ask me to give account of my stewardship. Thirdly, ministry with accountability in view calls for enduring fruits. For me, verse 12a, using gold, silver, and costly stones points to what lasts, what endures. I know Paul was not talking about ordinary gold or silver. Of course, he stands. It's not talking about superstructure we put together and we decorate it. That's not what it is all about. But he's talking about working hard in God's vineyard to leave legacies that will outlast us. I think that is the essence of it. But when I now come back to the Lord God of glory, I will have something to offer. The servants, giving 1 talent, 5 talents, 10 talents. And those with greater ones, 3. I will with boldness. And so you give me so much, and I have gained so much. That's the reason why to whom much is given, much more is expected. So, I encourage you to make sure that in terms of the ministry with accountability in view, you will continue to work harder to make sure that your fruit will remain, will last. John 15:16, that is what the Lord expects of us. And today, I am being taught again and again, over and over again and again, Paul's commitment to excellence in ministry. And I read him, of course, read the message of God through him. What are the legacies you are leaving behind? where you are right now. What are you putting together? Well, if it is mere monument, fine. I pray the monument will be such that will inspire people to do something much more in extending and expanding God's kingdom. But we are talking about the blood of human beings in my hand. For me, the politicians that I interact with, oh Lord, have mercy upon me. These top level corporate gurus that I interact with, oh Holy Father, please help me. That when they gather to listen to me, they will be jolted from their comfort zones. And I will not be held accountable for their blood. Lord, help me. And I get that opportunity every now and then. Shall I let them pass without making sure that God will be happy with me? What about you? So ministry with accountability in view calls for enduring fruits. Who are your Timothys? Who are your Silases? Who will continue to multiply your kind? Fruits that will last. And some of you here, loaded. So much more inside you that you can write and you are not writing. How am I going to read some warnings from the Lord through you? Or after you are dead and we buried you? Has someone said that the wealthiest place in the whole world is in cemetery, where you find so many people that are buried there who never make serious impact, whose fruit undead, rotted, destroyed. Lord help me. Oh God, Lord help me. Is it procrastination, laziness, the discipline preventing me from what I ought to do and prioritize? Lord help me. The last thing I want to mention is that ministry with accountability in view calls for personal assessment. Ministry with accountability in view calls for personal assessment, personal appraisal, personal evaluation. Because in consequence and in view of the impending day of accountability, is it not the responsibility of the steward to begin to actually examine and take stock before the master comes? Is that not what it's all about? I have that responsibility, you do. No one else must do it for you. And it must be done on a daily basis. Whatever we are engaged in, it is quite obvious that we can measure what we are doing. Vis-a-vis how God will measure us when we stand before Him. I think it is our personal responsibility. And if it is possible, why don't you find someone else to do a thorough X-ray of what you are doing right now? Some good friends, accountability group that can really it dissect you well, well. If you don't have one, you better get some individuals around you now. They may be younger than you. People will only ask you serious, penetrating questions. Because they are afraid to say it directly. But they will ask questions. Oh, I love that. And I had one like that. Majority of them, students that I taught, but now my colleagues in ministry. But we work together, and they sharpened me. Time of the third year. Are you engaging in that self-assessment? Because I just want you to consider something. The strength of our passage on part C, and it talks about but each one should be careful how he builds. To me personally, that's stocktaking. That's personal appraisal, assessment. A friend said to another friend, when he told him he was among a new set of deacons being considered, and the man simply said to this friend, "Bawo ma jo ba ma o, siwo ma ra re ni." It's like a question. That man was also, you know, "I'm going to be a deacon. I'm going to be a deacon." And the friend simply asked him, "If the members of the church don't know you, don't you know yourself? For God's sake, and you are a little over what? And you know you are not qualified. Don't you know yourself?" For me, I know Paul takes this personal step taking for assessment, for appraisal, very seriously. When he warned the believers, even in Corinthians, the only thing is something, that is nothing. He deserves himself. And it wants to test his own actions. Then you can begin to take pride in yourself without comparing yourself with somebody else. You find that in Galatians. And then 2 Corinthians 13, 5 says, "Examine yourself to see whether you are in the faith." I pray and ask the Lord that He will help me. He will help me. As He's reminding me now that ministry with accountability in view actually calls for soberness and humility. It calls for excelling in ministry. It really calls for enduring fruits. Of course, it calls for personal assessment. Will you help me finish my sermon by looking at one of our hymns, and we will read it. Verse number 9, we sang it yesterday. "Lord, give me light." Do you have it? That's personal appraisal. Powerful prayer. Can we read it together, please? "If I have not forsaken all, in answer to thy loving call, if I have kept something back from you, Lord, give me light that I may not see. Lord, help me judge my service day to walk this new and living way. I seek thy grace with all my heart to be made pure, just as thou art. If anything upon this earth attracts me with a sense of worth, if money has a hold on me, Lord, give me light that I might see. Number three, if all my life revolves around me and thoughts of my own family, if I am living selfishly, Lord, give me light that I might see. Is there some good I shall have done? Is there some soul I shall have won? Have I hurt someone thoughtlessly? Lord, give me light that I might see. If someone's failure has not wrought concern and care within my heart, if I have judged others inwardly, Lord, give me light that I might see. If I have cared for man's applause or set my own and shunned the cross, if I have feared man's mockery, Lord, give me light that I might see. If I have not sought thy power in prayer because of heavenly toils and care, if I am not longing for thee, Lord, give me light that I might see. Let us pray. Father, we have just prayed. Holy Spirit, we ask you to help us. Father, please help us. Knowing that as we engage in ministering with accountability in view, we will do our utmost best to satisfy you, to be approved by you. Lord, we bless you and we thank you. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.